welcome to a brand new mini-series here at Garsington at Home, the Opera Garden. I'm Katie Breathwick. It is my absolute pleasure to welcome you to the glorious, secluded, wonderful, secret spot on the Wormsley estate, the walled garden. Wormsley has been the home of Garsington Opera's summer festival since 2011, and each year we've had the delight of watching the gardens blossom on warm summer evenings filled with music. We want to bring you just a little taste of that delight, this year sadly only in digital form, so that you can continue to enjoy that special combination of horticulture and musiculture entwined at Garsington. Just as operas need directors, designers and conductors, gardens need a passionate team of artists and technicians to bring them to fruition. So we are delighted to be bringing you this series with Wormsley Estate's head gardener, Charlotte Tremlin. And this week we'll be looking at the rose garden, as well as hearing her tips and tricks for making cut flower bouquets. And finally, after so many weeks without live performance, we are particularly excited to bring you a short performance by Benjamin Hewlett here in the Walled Garden at the end of this episode. So, without further ado, let's go and find Charlotte in the Rose Garden.
My name's Charlotte Tremlin and I'm the head gardener here at Wormsley. The walled garden was here in about 1760. It was designed by a man called Richard Woods, who was a contemporary of Capability Brown. The garden is sited here and it's about a mile away from the house. And it's sited here because it's got the best soil, the best light, and a water supply. We've got two underground water wells under the ground. The garden now is a pleasure garden and a produce garden. Originally in 1760 it would have just been a produce garden. It wouldn't have had all these beautiful rose beds and all the perennial beds. It would have just been used for producing vegetables and cut flowers for the house. Now, in the mid 80s when the Gettys bought the estate, they enlisted the help of Penelope Hobhouse, who redesigned the whole garden and designed it into four sections. We have a produce garden, a cutting garden, a rose garden, a green theatre and a croquet lawn. We have three of us full time and then I have an army of six freelancers. We look after this garden, which is two acres, and then we look after about another 8 acres of formal gardens, including the opera garden near the auditorium. The rose garden was put in the early 90s when it was part of Penelope Hobhouse's design. And then in 2011, what we did is we stripped the whole of the rose garden out because it got past its best. So we stripped the whole garden out. We dug down to 120 centimetres, down to the chalk bed, put a membrane in, and then filled the beds up with mushroom compost and spent horse manure, and then planted the roses. We all sat down and said, we've got lots of pink in the garden, let's have a lot more of the deeper colours. So we chose things like the Darcy Bustle and Munstead Wood as the deep pinks, and then we went for the more pale pinks like Alexandra of Kent, and then we've done Charlotte, had to be added, and some of the oranges, Pat Austin and things like that. So we use the roses in vases, they go up to the house, I cut them. And they'll go into little jugs, so they make nice little simple arrangements during the opera season in vases, in the loos and on the bar of the champagne terrace. And we do something that's quite harsh, I suppose. We'll deadhead these roses about three times a week just so that we can get perfect blooms. So on a Thursday I'll go through and we'll completely cut blooms that you would probably leave in your domestic garden, but we won't. So because we want it to look really lovely over the weekend for all the guests. So we feed these roses. So through the winter, we'll feed them with bone meal and a good topping of horse manure. And then later on in the spring, we'll use blood, fish and bone. And then we'll carry on using that at 2 week intervals just to keep them. And water, most important. We've got irrigation pipe in here, which makes a huge difference. My old tutor, he said to me that 0400 was the best time to water. Because the water was cheap when on the old days, it was cheap rates, wasn't it? And just that there's less people using it, so you've got good pressure. Okay, so this one is just for cut for a vase. So I've cut for lots of length because I want to be able to put that in a nice jug or something on the table. But if I was deadheading, I would take it down a little bit further, right down to the bottom, and make sure I've taken the whole thing off and not left any petals on the ground. So let me show you this one. Here is absolutely perfect. That would be the kind of rose that I would take off so that to promote some more blooms. So I would take that right down and make sure I don't spill any petals, because that's what causes all the pests and diseases to hide under. Here we're going to move out of the rose garden and walk down the cross paths to the centre of the garden. So come this way. The peonies are all just coming out here now. They were only planted about 3 years ago. And this is the entrance I suppose most people are familiar about, coming in through here when they come down on the vintage coach. So the crossborders are all beginning to look at their best, the roses are coming out. This was redesigned in 2012 by Hannah Gardner, who was Garsington Opera's head gardener. We've adapted it a little bit for Wormsley climate and the fact that we've only got very narrow borders here. With the yew hedge, which saps quite a lot of the moisture. So come this way. Allium christophii is coming out over here. The salvia is coming out and flowering beautifully. Moonlight rose is looking fantastic now, and all the alliums are still in bloom. The centre of the garden, which is a bit cooler here than it is in the rose garden, so the shade from the Malus hupensis, they've just stopped blooming, and it was like a tower of confetti down here on one day when it was quite windy and all the blossom came down. I came down, it looked like there was snow on the ground.
So while Charlotte's getting ready to build that beautiful bouquet for us, we thought we'd like to share with you just a little moment of what it's like to come here to Wormsley and experience Garsington Opera. And we thought we'd share with you something from a production that we put on 3 years ago, The Marriage of Figaro. And it's perfect for this moment. It's all about nature. It's all about the breeze in the trees. And it's the moment that the Countess and Susanna come together for a duet. Enjoy.
Thank you.
We're going to put a vase together, the kind of vase that I put on the champagne terrace for the opera. So we're going to select some flowers and put them together. So I've got phylicterum here. There's some of this in the garden near the auditorium, so I thought I'd use that. End of May, June, peonies, gorgeous. Allium christophii, you know, absolutely beautiful. So we're going to put a mixture of those together and maybe with some delphiniums, which are just coming into bloom here. So you tend to work in odd numbers in bouquets so that it doesn't look too uniform. You don't want straight lines. So you use threes, fives, sevens, nines in all of floristry. So flowers, cutting from your garden, the best time to cut flowers are first thing in the morning when it's really cool. And then you want to cut their stems and give them a really lovely sharp angle. And then submerse them in cold water, put them in a cool place for a couple of hours before you start arranging them, and then you'll get the best out of them. So we're going to start with a base. And I tend to spiral all stems. It's an old habit from being a florist, because you've spiraled all your stems for bouquets. So I still do it in vases. What you do is you just make sure you're going round in the same direction, and then your bouquet should then stand up. You just keep going round, building up. So I'm building up, so I've got a nice three there. And then I'm just going to keep building. It's just like building blocks and turning round. Keep sweeping round. Keep turning, and because you spiraled, that shouldn't fall apart. So this is really, you know, proper summer, isn't it? The pink and the purple and the blues and the limey yellows, you know, that just feels like summer. I think all seasons have sort of a colour for them. So in early spring you want all those lovely yellows and limey colours, and then you move into these lovely soft pastel pinks and blues, and then as the summer gets sort of hotter and drier, you then get to all the yellows and the oranges and all those sort of autumnal colours. And I think all the light, that just the light just suits it. And then the other point to make is that you don't want any foliage below the waterline, because that causes bacteria in the water and makes the water go a funny colour. So then all I do, chop off the ends, trying to put them in the bucket. And there you go. A vase.
What a treat. Thank you so much for joining us. I really hope you've enjoyed this wonderful, spectacular location here at the Wormsley Estate. Thanks to Charlotte, the head gardener. And do come back and join us again. We've got more like this in store, but right now, a live performance. We're going to hear Benjamin Hewlett sing an old English folk song.
I will give my love an apple without ever core. I will give my love a house without e'er a door. I will give my love a palace wherein she may be, and she will unlock it without any key. My head is the apple without e'er a core. My mind is the house without e'er a door. My heart is the palace wherein she will be, and she